Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the state of South Carolina. Hope you guys are doing all right. Praise be to God, Most High, Creator of heaven and earth. You know, brothers and sisters, you know, I was just sitting here thinking about, and praying, and, just in my mind thinking about the orphans and stuff, brothers and sisters, and the feeding we're doing. I just want to thank the Lord we've been feeding. I haven't made a slideshow every month because it's just so hard to make, brothers and sisters. Not hard physically, but hard, mentally or emotionally to make it because the need is just unbelievable, brothers and sisters. We feed like 800 kids at least once a week, and we tell them about the Lord and all this. If you have never been to, if you'd like to join our Facebook group, I posted like a couple pictures every day, either the orphans or the feedings and all that. So the Facebook group is, the link is below here. It's Joshua's Ministry Facebook, and then the group is Joshua's Ministry. If you're on Facebook, I invite you. That's where I was most active. We have a website too, Joshua's Ministry, where I have all the information about people want to donate, and I've got like a little bio on the on each orphan and stuff like that on a page on there, things like that. But the most active thing is the Facebook. You know, it's just the way the technology is. The Facebook is the easiest and the best. But anyway, I've been thinking about the orphans and stuff, brothers and sisters, and about the feeding and what a great need it is. we have 5 boxes already on the way from a brother and sister in California, and then a sister Pearly in the Chicago area. This is the third time we'll be sending boxes. Sister Pearly's the one's putting it together. I think she's going to send them probably by the end of the month. It almost might be too late to get in contact with her. If you would just go to the Facebook group, Sister Pearly's information is there. You can email me. I can give you Sister Pearly her email, and maybe you can send some stuff. We need children's summer clothes, you know, toothbrushes, children's, writing notepads for school, paper, pens, crayons, anything like that, children's toys. You know, anything that the Lord would lead you to send, it will be awesome. We can use it. We have the orphans. We have over 30 orphans. It fluctuates because we're getting a new kid in. One kid, their grandparents maybe want them to come live with them, and one will leave. And it's kind of in a flux, brothers and sisters. We have some that's been there since the very beginning, some that's come and stayed for a while, then their family decided that they couldn't live without them, and they went back. Things like that, brothers and sisters. And then for the feeding programs, we feed the street kids, poor kids. Maybe their father is a coconut tree climber, and 4 times a year they harvest the coconuts, and then that's the only time they work. And then they get a little pay from that. Then the rest of the year, you know, they borrow money from the landowner, and then when they do the harvest, they have to pay back. So it ends up, you know, maybe they make $20 a month on average if they were lucky. Their pay is about $20 a month. And, you know, in the Philippines, of course, the people don't have money for birth control, and then, of course, 90% of Filipinos are allegedly Catholic. They have a Catholic tradition, you know, just like in the States, though. You talk to people, whatever, you know, they say they're Christian, they say they're Baptist, they say they're Catholic, whatever people might say, most people aren't active anything, and they don't know anything. So the average people that we're dealing with, they have no education, maybe first or second grade. Most of them maybe went to the second grade and had to quit school to work to support their family. You know, they have no shoes. They live in a shack. No running water, no electricity on the land of the coconut farm. And they're just tenant farmers or sharecroppers there. And, you know, this is their kids. And the parents didn't go to school. You know, the average person in this crowd probably dies at 40 years old, has a stroke and dies. You know, the men, the alcoholism rate is at least 90%. And then, you know, most of them are not married because they don't have money. But what they do is every year in the Philippines, they have the what they call a barangay captain, which is like the leader of a little area, say, you know, just a little district, a little small thing, a whole lot smaller than a city or a county. Say it might be 2 or 3 square miles. And then they have a captain there. And in other words, if you get arrested, the local police, they have the barangay police, they can come arrest you, and they can even have a little court trial at the barangay captain level if it's not a major crime. And then it gets kicked up to the police and to the state level and all that. So, or whatever. But anyway, once a year they can have these mass weddings, you know, with the tribal people. And then the barangay captain can marry people. And so lots of them get married through that. And it's free. You know, the government just processes. Instead of going through all, Philippines has major, I got married over there. You know, it takes months you know, they make it so complicated, no wonder people don't get married. But anyway, they have this for poor people. They have a fast-track thing, and it didn't really cost them anything, so that's good. And I think that's great. We should encourage people to get married. Anyway, instead of just living together. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I want to show you, I've got some vials. A dear sister had sent me 120 vials today to get us started. I have some more oil. I got a big nice glass jar of oil now. These vials are glass too, so I've got to get some kind of padded envelopes to put them in, you know, like with a plastic inside there. I want to wrap them in plastic bubble probably, so in case even if they got busted, they wouldn't leak, you know, and kind of seal it up. Maybe even a little cellophane with a Ziploc tag, and then put it in that's probably would be good. A little cellophane Ziploc bag, and then put it inside of a padded envelope, you know, with the bubbles in it, like a little pop bubbles, I guess. And then I say, I'm going to drop it, break it now. I got a thing on this, it's a glass table. Anyway, and then I need to get a printer. I don't have a printer. I need to get a printer anyway, and, you know, I need it for, I got to print out my insurance information and all kinds of stuff to put in the vehicle. Anyway, so I'll get a printer and then figure out how to do it. Got to figure it out to get labels. I don't think it may be nowadays. Everything's so easy. Maybe it's not so complicated. I'm going to make a little label for each one. I'll put my, you know, this is anointing. I'll put my name on there. Then I want to put my email address and stuff. And people can contact me if they have any questions. You know what we need to do, brothers and sisters? I'll probably stick like a, I was thinking about making like a little pamphlet with prayers on it and stuff, which I can do, but people might lose that. What I need to do, brothers and sisters, I really need to make an app. I'm just thinking about it. It'd be really cool. I don't know how to do it, but I know there's lots of, you know, I had five IT people volunteer last time when we made the virtual church, the Church of the Firstborn. So I know God has people out there. You know, maybe we can make an app. Or on the website, Church of the Firstborn, we can put, you know, a page with all of these, you know, not a set prayer, but frequently asked questions and answers about prayer. And we're going to do that. I'm going to put that together, and I need to get the website worked on. So we'll do that. And I asked you guys for any help and suggestion and all these things. It'd be great. The response for the anointing oil has been overwhelming. And, you know, I'm surprised. I mean, the Lord's the one that gave me the idea to do it. You know, just out of the blue, the Lord spoke to me about doing it. So I guess I should not be surprised that there's been a huge, overwhelming request for the oil. Brothers and sisters, like I said, I'm going to pray over this. I've got some frankincense someone sent me, and I'm going to crush it up, and I'm going to mix a little bit in the oil, and then someone gave me the essential oil of frankincense and myrrh, and I'll use that too, and mix up the oil, and I'm going to be praying over it. I want to, you know, really like fast and pray over it for several days, and I want to, you know, keep praying over it every day. When I pray, I'll keep laying hands on these bottles and praying over it, and I'll even pray over it on the videos like I did last time with a small bottle. And then I'll be ready to send it out, let's just say by mid-November. So by the end of November, you know, people should be able to get it. So I need to set up a website if people want to make an offering toward, you know, the postage and handling and all this cost. It'll be the printer and all the things and the labels and whatnot. I know God will provide, and there's people who, brothers and sisters, there'll be people who cannot, you know, legitimately cannot donate. And then, of course, we want to give them the anointing oil also, brothers and sisters. So, you know, I know the Lord will provide that where I can give away some of the oil to those who cannot afford. God knows who can and cannot. And, you know, there are people who are legitimately in a financial crisis, and the oil would help them. You know, they can pray over there. You know, you can use prayer. Of course, you can pray for all things, brothers and sisters. I can make a video about that. But, you know, one of the biggest problems people do have is financial problems. You know, and God blesses us in all ways, brothers and sisters. As every video I've made this week, the Lord keeps prompting me. And when I sat down to make this video right now, the Lord keeps prompting me with that doxology song, you know, the last hymnal in most of your hymnal books, you know. And the part that the Lord is quickening to me about that is, you know, whenever the Lord gives you something, it's not like, ooh, that's a cool song. There's something in there He wants you to hear and receive. So the first sentence of that song is the message that the Lord is giving me and the message that the Lord wants me to share with you. Is praise God through whom all blessings flow. So all blessings flows through God. As the Bible says, you know, all good things come from above. All good things come from God. That includes finances, brothers and sisters. I wasn't intending on speaking about this, but God is our provider in all things. And, you know, it's sad that the prosperity gospel people have hijacked you know, have hijacked and made, you know, it's just like the greasy gracers and extreme gracers who are running around saying, oh, even, you know, it's a work to say, Jesus, forgive me. If you say out loud, Jesus, I believe you died on the cross and forgive me my sins, that's already a work. Where the Bible says, all who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You call on him, you know. And it says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and God has raised him from the dead and believe in your heart, you know, that God has raised from the dead, thou shalt be saved. So you confess with your mouth. You're supposed to speak. And you're supposed to repent. In the book of Acts, it tells us, Paul, when he was preaching, he said, God calls all men everywhere to repent. So we are to repent of our sins. So that, just as I'm saying here, the extreme gracers, extreme greasy gracers have hijacked, you know, God's grace. And people will make this, brothers and sisters. People will say, you know, free gift. And if it's a gift, of course it's free. If it's not free, it's not a gift. But anyway, so people have hijacked and made this extreme hyper grace, greasy grace statements. And there's denominations that are moving in that area so much that it's hijacked the fact that God does give us grace. God's grace is there for us. God's grace is more than enough. God's grace is sufficient for us. It covers all sins, his grace, when we repent. His grace is more than enough for all of our sin when we repent, brothers and sisters, and turn from them. Repent means to be remorseful. To, you know, you feel guilty, you're remorseful, you ask the Lord to forgive you, and then you turn from your ways. You make a turn. You turn from your sin. And you ask God to give you the strength and help to return from it. When you fail again, you ask the Lord to do it again. You know, you repent, go through the process again and again as many times as it takes. And keep pressing for the Lord to help you and keep pressing toward the mark of the high calling, the Bible says, in Christ Jesus. Anyway, so on the prosperity part, the prosperity people have also hijacked the prosperity of God. And they've hijacked the fact that God wants to bless us. Even as John said, brethren, it's in 2 John or 3 John, I wish above all, brethren, or whatever it says, beloved, I wish above all things that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. You know, so God wants us to prosper and be in health, even as our soul prospers, that we would walk with the Lord, that we would be blessed with divine health, and we'd be blessed in all things. They would have dominion, brothers and sisters. But to keep it in perspective, it is also true that everyone dies. As I said at the end of the video I made last time, we all die of something. No one's walking around here 200 or 300 years old. You know, there was one brother who was telling me about a pastor he had who believed he would live and not die until Jesus returned, that he wouldn't die because of his faith. But it's, we all die of something. If the Lord tarries, we will die of something. Because sin and death reign in this life, brothers and sisters. Our spirit's been redeemed, but our human, the body calls, you know, the Bible calls our corruptible earthen vessel, which it is an earthen vessel, like a earthen jar. It's made out of clay. Our body's made out of dirt, of dust, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, right? Like they say in some of these funeral ceremonies. We came from dirt. We came from dust, and dust we shall return, as God told Adam, because he sinned and ate of the fruit of the knowledge of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So, brothers and sisters, even though we die of something, if the Lord tarries and doesn't return in our lifetime, but yet God heals people and God does miracles. And even though there are people who are fed to the lions, there are other people, for whatever God chose people, to bring glory to his name in different ways. God chose Joseph from the Bible, the son of Jacob, to bring glory to his name by being at the right hand of Pharaoh and having all this abundant, overflowing provision. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob also flowed in over more than enough of everything. Go read in Genesis. You will see that they were very wealthy people. They were mighty. Abraham was called a mighty prince among the people. As when his wife died and he went there to buy land in the field in the cave of Mamre, they told him, they said, you know, you're a mighty prince among the people here. Abraham was. He made like an army. When he went to rescue his nephew Lot and the other people from who were taken captive from Sodom and Gomorrah, he gathered an army of his own servants. And I can't remember the number now. I think it's 175. He had 175, I think it is. Maybe 150, 175 able-bodied men out of his servants who were able to carry a sword and go fight not counting the women and children and the old people of his servants. You know, and so God blesses people. But there's other people that are called to suffer for the Lord in different ways, whether it be, you know, through poverty, through being the people who are killed and who are being killed by ISIS right now, who are Christians. And in the Sudan, they've crucified Christians. In Saudi Arabia, they persecute Christians. In China, they persecute Christians. All the things going on in the world. But there are people also who are called to be, you know, to be a billionaire businessman who God can use to build orphanages, 1,000 orphanages around the world. You know, give away 1 million Bibles, whatever. Brothers and sisters, all these things are possible through Christ, through the blood of Jesus, through the name of Jesus, through the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, brothers and sisters, when I see lots of people, they only judge God by their own experience. Not by looking at things from a whole, not look from things from their own perspective, but from the Word of God, and then what they see in the kingdom of God, and what they hear from other people, what God is showing them, the way God sees things. So, brothers and sisters, we don't choose our destiny, even though people who you know, the most of the world, especially men, the problem with most men is their theme song is, you know, Frank Sinatra, "I Did It My Way." You know, they love to sing that. In the Philippines, they have the karaoke all over the place. And most of the older men there, they love to get all liquored up and sing videoke, or they call it videoke there, karaoke. And they love to sing that song. Frank Sinatra / Elvis Presley sang it too. "I Did It My Way." And that's the problem. They do it their way, not the Lord's way. So they try to choose their own destiny, be the captain of their own ship, and be the captain of their own destiny, when in reality, God has given us a destiny. And then it's our job to discover the destiny that God has given us. And we all have that gifting and calling to whatever it may be, brothers and sisters. So it really boils down to knowing that it's from God and embracing what God has given you. You know, as they say, the expression is, if the world, but if God gives you lemons, make lemonade. Brothers and sisters, make the best of a bad situation, as another song goes. We have to make the best of a bad situation or a good situation, whatever it may be. We must do all to the glory of God. And I'm saying this in such generic terms because it's true. There are some of you who have cancer. You can bring glory to God. And the Lord, I pray, and the anointing oil sent it to you, that God will heal you. And I believe God will heal you. But sometimes God says, no, it's your time to go home. It's appointed unto man, to all people, every man to die and then the judgment. To once to die and then the judgment. We all must die. It's appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment. So we all must die unless the Lord returns for the rapture in our lifetime, which I believe he will. But no man knows the day or the hour. Brothers and sisters, take whatever the Lord has given you and bring glory to his name with it. Accept. When you know it's from the Lord, accept it. Don't fight the Lord. But you know, it's hard. I'm giving this generic advice. Let me say this. There are people who are in a situation that's not from God. So, of course, we don't want you to, I don't want you to accept, you know, the bed you find yourself lying in as if it's not from God. So, lots of times, let's say this, 99%. If you are living in sin and you're not right with God, you're unrepentant, you're a backslider, lukewarm, or never was a Christian, then you're probably not where God, you're in the wrong bed. You're not in the bed and the place where the Lord has assigned you. You're out of his will. So you need to repent, call upon the name of the Lord, get born again, get saved, ask God to fill you with his Holy Spirit, start reading the New Testament, get right with God, listen to sermons and teachings and videos like mine, or, you know, and godly men, servants of God, and on even some on Christian television. There is some good preaching. It's hard to find, but there is. Most of it is just fundraising. But anyway, and nonsense. But if you, you know, get mentored and discipled, get yourself discipled, get yourself connected in a situation where you can be discipled in the Lord, then, you know, you seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened to you. Ask and you shall receive, that you might line up with the will of God in your life and the destiny that God has for you. Whether it is to be a martyr, whether it is to get on a plane and fly to Africa and pray for and help take care of Ebola patients. And then it may be, you know, your destiny is to go there and get Ebola, and that God may heal you, or that God may let you come home. And that was his will for you. I don't know. Every situation is totally different, brothers and sisters, and God has different reasons in his purposes for all things, brothers and sisters. And the Lord, the first thing that I wrote in my prayer journal, the Lord led me to start a prayer journal, and I started it on January the 7th, 2002. Yeah, I'll say January the 7th, 2002. The first journal entry I put in my prayer journal from the Lord was, settle it in your heart now. As long as you're in this world, you will have tribulation. You will have tribulation in this world. Now, the reason the Lord told us that in the Bible, we would have tribulation. But the reason why the Lord told me that that day, which is January the 7th, 2002, was because I had, since I'd become a Christian, I've been watching Christian television. And there's lots of good things on there, but there's lots of things that is out of balance. And I got it in my mind that, hey, you know, nothing bad can happen to me at all because I'm totally walking with the Lord, totally walking by faith. How could anything possibly bad happen to me? You know, and that was my prayer. And then the Lord spoke to me and said, settle it in your heart right now. As long as you're in this world, you'll have tribulation. You know, we are in an imperfect world. That's when it says in there, it's not talking about the Bible. It says when that which is perfect has come. When that which is perfect has come, what is that? The kingdom of Jesus Christ. When the Lord returns to this earth at the end of the tribulation, he will put an end to sin, sickness, death, hell, and the grave. As it says, you know, the Apostle Paul wrote, says death will be, you know, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Those will be swallowed up. You know, death, hell, and the grave will be swallowed up. But it's not yet. People still die. We are spiritually redeemed. That's why it says God put an earnest on us. He sealed us with his Holy Spirit. But we have not been redeemed yet. You know, we're still in this fallen world. We're still in this. We're still walking around with an old Coke bottle. You know, it hasn't been redeemed. The Lord has put a deposit on us, but we have not been redeemed back to the factory, the bottling factory, like a Coca-Cola bottle or a Pepsi bottle like it used to be before, brothers and sisters, before the 2 liter, before the age of plastic, 2 liters. There was a deposit that you had to pay when you bought some sodas, and then you would take it back and they would give you back your deposit. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm just laying, talking all these general topics as the Lord is leading me. I want to thank all of those who have helped with Joshua's ministry. You know, as I've said many times, it's always frustrating. Not frustrating, it's hurtful in my spirit, and I'm sure, you know, it's from the Lord. When I make a video about the rapture, a dream of the rapture, a vision of the rapture, and 2,000 or 3,000 people watch it. And then I make a video about the orphanage update, 200 or 300 people watch it. And, you know, it's not me. You know, it doesn't matter to me. I mean, God is providing for the orphanages. We have 2 orphanages. And the 800 kids we feed and all those other things that we've done, we've planted, we've built some churches and different things as the Lord leads. We buy guitars for churches that haven't, you know, in the middle of the mountains, they don't have electricity or running water. Give them, you know, an acoustic guitar, give Bibles, whatever, you know, I've given out of my own money before Joshua's ministry. I did all those things and I gave, and you know, and then through Joshua's ministry, we're still doing it. I give like a dress shirt to pastors. We do now, those who have helped. We use some of the money we bought, like a dress shirt. There's lots of pastors that don't even have a shirt. They just got like an old torn up t-shirt. Give them a dress shirt. Sometimes we give them dress shoes. They don't have any shoes, just like flip-flops. Give them, you know, some dress shoes. Giving them dress pants. Give them a Bible. Whatever the need is, brothers and sisters, as I find out about needs and run into situations, you know, God has, you know, used me to provide. And then I've used my own money before Joshua's ministry, and then you guys have donated. Those who have donated, and then, you know, I've used the money that you donated for all those things, the orphanage, the feedings, all those things, whatever God would have us do, brothers and sisters, on and on and on. I know the Lord provides. The Lord is the one to do it, not me or even you, those who donate. We're just all instruments of the Lord. But brothers and sisters, like I say, it's very saddening to me in my spirit, from the Lord's spirit. The world is really so cold. People are wax cold. They're so wax cold, brothers and sisters. That's why I ask you to pray for them. Because the very ones who are running to and fro, calculating all these rapture dates and all that stuff, and when they stand before the Lord at the Bema seat, the judgment seat of Christ, which all Christians will face the judgment seat of Christ, it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 that our deeds will be, you know, go through the fire, whether they be of gold or hay or stubble. You know, and the things that are done in a pure motive, in the right heart, in right spirit, not for our own glorification. Things that we've done for God's glory and not our own glory, and for His praise and worship will be gold and will be our rewards. The things that we've done in our flesh, but the most part of people, that's why people love to say, oh, this preacher so-and-so, he did it to make it, to exalt himself. Like, I hear people saying that. Maybe that's true. Maybe it's not. The Lord is the judge. But the point is they did something. 90% of the church, I will take that back, 2% of Christians, they say, tithe. So let's say 98% of those who claim to be part of the body of Christ doing absolutely nothing, brothers and sisters, for the Lord. And then there's a crowd, I don't know how much percent it is, let's say it's 1% of the church, that criticizes that 2% that's doing something, doing the work of Satan, as the things that God hates. You've heard of that, they made a movie, you know, the seven deadly sins, and people talk about the seven deadly sins. One of them is, you can go Google it and look it up in the Bible from the Old Testament. One of those is people who are quick to spread, you know, discontent among the brethren, to sow discord among the brethren. And that's those people. You know, I mentioned it a little bit before. I don't like to get into it too much, but most of the people who are on YouTube making these attack videos, as an example, of course, they're in every church. There's people in every church who are quick to sow discord among the brethren, doing the work of the devil, doing the work of tares, tearing down where God didn't call them as some kind of a prophet to tear down wickedness in the church. God has men of God who He has called really to a prophetic ministry, and that is a true prophetic ministry, you know, to bring the word of the Lord to leadership in the government and in the church and anywhere else the Lord would deem. They would speak the mind of God to those, you know, in leadership, basically, usually, not just giving people a word all the time. That's part of it. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I've touched on many different topics, you know, and I'm just making a video. I guess this is more of a vlog than a sermon. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I just want to tell you I love you guys. And then, you know, the orphans and all that stuff, it's a killer, man. It's a killer, you know, to know that it's just like, you know, a wave tossed in the ocean. Like that song, you know, Who Am I? And the singer Casting Crowns is saying, you know, I'm like a wave tossed in the ocean, you know, from Jude. But, you know, the ministry, Joshua's ministry is just a wave tossed in the ocean. You know, we can only do so much. You know, and the Bible says in Psalm 127, except the Lord build the house, those that labor in vain. So I'll let the Lord build Joshua's ministry. The Lord has been building Joshua's ministry and growing it. And brothers and sisters, I'm just along for the ride. Just like all of those guys who are part of this ministry, who donate, who pray. There's some people that can't donate and they pray. That's more valuable than money is prayer. So I want to thank all of those of you who have prayed. You know, we have a prayer group on the Church of the Firstborn, you know, to pray for people. And we can pray for you. We have a prayer team. And I ask you to submit your prayer request. The link for the website for the Church of the Firstborn is below this video. The link for the Facebook group is below this video. And then I added information. The Lord, also a brother has been advising me a couple of times just to open a Bitcoin account. So I did, brothers and sisters. It's kind of exciting because, you know, the exchange rate with that Bitcoin is really good, you know, like to the Philippines and things like that. So I've set one up here in the States for now. So I get used to it, make sure everything's cool with it. And then I'm going to, you know, hook it up. When I go to the Philippines, I'm going to hook it up to my account there in the Philippines. And then I can transfer it from my account to the account of the First House Mom. You know, I can get our accounts linked there where I can, you know, because I want to handle this Bitcoin and make sure that everything's cool with it. If there's any problem, I can do it, you know, from here. And the House Mom, of course, wouldn't be able to handle all that, especially like trying to call here in the States or whatever may need to be done. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm trying to think, make sure I covered everything. Like I said, I'm going to add, I asked Brother Martin, who did the website for the patrickwinfrey.com, which is for the book. You know, all these websites that I've done, I didn't do it. The Lord did it. And Brother Martin has helped with a lot of them. Sister Elaine did the Church Firstborn. Brother Sid is the moderator of that channel. And we have the prayer warriors and all that stuff. And then, you know, the Lord gave me the wisdom to write this book. Sister Rosemary Kelly helped me, you know, edited it and helped me write it, you know, put it down on paper, on the computer, and dictated a lot of part of the book for me, so I didn't have to sit there and type it all out myself. You know, I haven't been able to do any of the ministry by myself. That's what I'm trying to say. You know, of course, the house moms and dads of the two orphanages, the pastors and the pastoras, they call them in the Philippines, pastoras, a female, the women pastoras, and the pastors, they've been doing the feedings and all that and teaching the kids and singing songs with them and all that stuff. I mean, I've gone around it myself and done lots of that, but I mean, I can't be everywhere. We're doing like, I think we're doing 14 or 15 feedings now. I can't even keep up with it. It's 800 kids plus. My conservative estimate is 800 kids spread out over a four-hour area, okay? And, you know, I could never do any of these things without all the people help. Those who have donated, I could not do, you know, the orphanage, the orphanages and all of that. You know, the budget is not low. And then we do all the feedings and all that, brothers and sisters. We have a pretty good budget that we're moving through every month, and God is providing. And the book that the Lord gave me to write, of course, the Lord inspired me. And then, you know, we got them printed. And then, you know, people have helped me send them out in different locations. I've left books in different locations. And there are different people who have helped me send them out, the signed copies. And I just want to thank the Lord. And I want to thank all of you guys publicly, like Sister Stephanie, Sister Michelle. As I've already mentioned, other people. And all the, I don't want to mention too many names because I can't mention everybody's name. I can't remember. You know, everybody's name and what they did. The sister that sent me these, I just got these in the mail today. The sister that bought the oil, the anointing oil, the olive oil, and the sister that sent me the frankincense. All those things, brothers and sisters. That's why I don't even want to mention this, because I'm going to forget somebody. I just want to thank all of you guys. I can't thank you enough. I could never help these kids without your help. And we could never do the, you know, the... I couldn't do this ministry by myself at all. I'm not a one-man army. You know, the Lord is the one, of course. But all of you guys who have helped me, I really appreciate it. I can't make it without you guys. I just want to thank you again. And you know that I love all you guys, and those of you who are my friends, you know, and brothers and sisters in the Lord, of course, and also friends. There are, you know, some of you guys who I even talk to on the phone sometimes. You know, before in the Philippines, I really couldn't talk to anybody on the phone because it's so expensive. But I've, you know, there's a few people that I got in contact with and talk on the phone, mature Christians. And, of course, you know, we talk and make some friends a little bit. And it's a blessing also. And so I just want to thank you guys who are my friends, besides brothers and sisters in the Lord. And there's lots more of you who I would love to talk to. You know, have been corresponding with me for four years now. I would love to talk to you and meet you guys. And as the Lord makes a way and the Lord leads, I will go to those places and see you guys. I know I wanted to go. I was gung-ho to go, and the Lord told me not to at this time, you know, to chill out right here. You know, I've got people that I want to visit in Nashville and all lots of places. West Virginia, Sister Holly, Nashville, lots of people in Nashville, Seattle, Las Vegas. I love all you guys and all those places in between. Southwest Florida, of course, Louisiana, all over Texas, Dallas, Houston, all those places. New Orleans, you know, I start naming cities. I can't name all the places. New York City, Brooklyn. I have friends, thank God, that the Lord has given me brothers and sisters slash friends in all these places. I can't even name all the places. Australia, all over Australia, Europe, many countries. France, Germany, England, of course, the UK, still the UK. God bless all you guys. And I just want to tell you that I love you all. I can't thank you enough. And I just don't, you know, I'm just glad to know you guys. And like I said, and the Lord had talked to me too. I keep forgetting to mention it. The Lord talked to me about Skyping with people. And I think I'm going to try to do some Skyping. Those of you who have a relationship with me through comments and all that, if you would like to Skype with me, I guess I need to make some kind of schedule. The problem with me, when I start talking to somebody and fellowshipping with them, you know, it goes on and on for hours. So I'm like, if I made a schedule, like to talk to a different person every hour, You know, you get, you know, some people you can, you know, you really, it's really something, you know, something good is happening. And ministry, and, you know, I just want to keep flowing with it. I mean, I'm like that. Once I get going, brothers and sisters. Anyway, God bless you guys. You know that I love you. This Ebola, like I know, I already said, it's only going to get worse. But that's the bad report of the world. So you're going to believe the good report, like Joshua and Caleb, or the bad report of the other spies, you know. God will make a way for us. God will make a way for us. You know, even if we got Ebola, you know, God will use us to bring glory to his name, however that is, brothers and sisters. Like I say, I'm one of the biggest proponents of healing. Don't ever doubt that about me. Of course, it doesn't matter what I think or don't think. It's all about the Lord. But, you know, I'm as hardcore gifts of the Spirit as of anybody you can meet. But I also know that God uses people to bring glory to his name in all kinds of ways. That's the theme of this video. And if God's glory is brought to me leaving this world by Ebola and being an example of suffering through grace, then that's God's will. And I'm all for doing his will. Even though sometimes we don't like it. Even though there's, you know, like the song, you know, goes, I've been singing lately, and I can't really sing, brothers and sisters, as you probably know. But just by the Spirit of the Lord, there's a song called Blessed Be Your Name. It's really about Job, you know. And it says, blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. I don't know. You have to go listen to it. Blessed be your name. It's a great song. You know, even though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name, Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Hallelujah. You give and take away. You give and take away. But my heart will choose to say, blessed be your name. So we have to choose to bless his name like Job did. His wife said, curse God and die. But Job didn't do that. No matter what happened, you know, by the grace of God, may I be half the man of God that Job was. And you should pray that too. By the grace of God, can I be half the man or woman that Job was? You know, because it's easier said than done. There's lots of people that live in a pie-in-the-sky theories, and they live in their little ivory tower in the States with their big, you know, high-definition 4D, whatever's the new thing they got, 4G or 4D flat-screen TV, you know, with their two-car garage and living their, you know, chasing the American dream. And they just don't know what it's like to have suffering. Lots of Americans are, as they say, fat and happy. They don't know what it's like. That's why, you know, I wish they would see the slideshows I made in the Philippines. Not just about Joshua's ministry. That maybe they'd get awakened to the fact that their heart is ice cold like a block of ice. You know, and it's not the heart of Christ. It's not the mind of Christ. Jesus said, suffer the little children to come unto me and forbid them not. You know, for such is the kingdom of heaven. So lots of people, you know, they're wax cold. And you can't be close to the Lord. You know, God is very passionate. God said, I'm a jealous God. You know, all the emotions we have are also created in the image of God. God is a very emotional being. He created all those love, all these things God created. Compassion and passion. God is a passionate God, and he loves passion and compassion in his people. You know, to be like God is to be compassionate, to be moved by compassion and love and all those things. So all these people, that's why I should make a whole separate video about this. I'm just getting inspired by God right now after 40 minutes. You go to these old dead religious ceremony churches, God is full of emotions, compassion and love and all that. Not some stiff, solemn garbage. God bless you guys. I don't want to get into it here in this video. God bless you guys. You know I love you. I've been keeping it low key all video. I don't want to get all fired up now. Anyway, God bless you guys and love you guys. And this video is basically just the ramblings of Pastor Patrick. God bless you guys.